Now, welcome today, everybody. My name is Mike van der Linden, and my colleague Ruud Verlind will take you with me in our research about fire safety in the aging population. The subtitle of the research, a probabilistic link of wave vent and wave pressure measures for residential buildings. I'm mouthful, but it does mean probabilistic. We use statics in our research. We want to make a wave pressure and wave vent link between each other for residential buildings, especially for the aging population. I'm not always an English speaker by native, so if something is unclear, you can always raise your hand and I want to clarify it a little bit more. Or I look to my left and maybe Ruud giving me some backup.
No problem.
Yeah, welcome. Again, my name is Mike van der Linden. I'm just graduated at the Technical University of Eindhoven in the topic fire safety. In my daily life, I'm also a volunteer of the fire department in my neighborhood, Vught. And at the TU, I did my master thesis about fire safety in the aging population. Ruud is one of my supervisors during this master, and maybe you can introduce yourself.
Yeah, why not? I'm a researcher here at the Fire Service Academy. I'm also a volunteer commander at the fire department, Schijndel City Center. and I was a supervisor of Mike in this thesis. One thing up front, if you have any questions, please ask them. But we are recording this on video to put it on the YouTube channel of the Fire Service Academy afterwards. You can ask it, and I want to ask Mike if you can repeat the question.
Okay.
If you do so, it will be on the audio of the video.
Of course.
Okay?
Yes.
Thank you.
You ready?
Yeah.
Okay. First, introduction of our presentation today. First, we start with the problem definition. What is now the real problem with the aging population in relation to fire safety? After that, I bring some research relevance. So what's difficult in my research of different comparing to other research into fire safety with aging population. I tell something about my method in the research, which steps I make. After that, we do a problem analysis, and we will end up with some possible measures. First, I bring some statics from here, the EFA. The EFA collected statics about the fatalities from residential buildings per age group of the last years. In the period of 2008 till 2016, these are the numbers each year. So in the age group of 60 till 80, each year there are around 8.7 fatalities as a result of a residential fire. People of 80 years and older are even 6.6 times involved in residential fires. If you compare this to the population in the Netherlands, the relations are a little bit different. You can see how older people are, how more risk they got to get involved by a residential fire. And blue line, the chance to get involved by a residential fire by 1 million people in the Netherlands, and in red the absolute numbers. Now, what's next? In the next years, next 10 years, to 2030, these numbers will grow. Several reasons I mentioned in my report, and some what I can mention is people live longer, are longer active, more healthy, and we got the baby boom a few years ago, and this is the result. So the government wants that people live for longer and staying at their homes. It's not always possible to put people always in care homes. It's much more expensive. So people have to live longer independently with possibilities for care at their homes. But it has some risks for the fire safety, because in the Netherlands the regulations are based on the building function and not on the humans that live in the building. So, some of you know this figure maybe. This is the relation of fire safety, the degree of fire safety according to the EFA. They say the degree of fire safety is determined by different characteristics. One of these characteristics is the fire characteristics. They are really the same in the last years. The building characteristics are always the same because the regulations are not different for older people. But the human characteristics are different. People are older, are reduced mobile, and yeah, there is something happening. So this has a negative influence to the degree of fire safety. Dus maybe we have something to change here, but it is not, yeah, not easy to do that. So maybe we can change here something, or in the relation on the other side to the intervention characteristics. In my research, I see this as a building characteristics, and this is all characteristics we can apply at the fire service. And all of them are dependent to the environmental characteristics. On the other side, the fire service has also some troubles. In the Netherlands, we got the besluitveiligheidsregio's. Maybe you can translate it as Fire Safety
Safety Region Act.
Okay. In the Safety Region Act, there are times mentioned where the fire service has to meet. So in residential buildings, they have to come with an intervention time of about 8 minutes. No region in the Netherlands can meet this set times. The average of Netherlands is about 52%. The maximum of 82 till 28% is the variation. So there are our troubles. Now, in my research, my main goal of the research is to improve the fire safety and especially among the older population. On the other side, in my research, I want to do a probabilistic approach. It's completely new, and I will do that with some statistics that I collected in my own safety region and from literature studies. I want to make the link between prevention and suppression, and I will do that quantitative. So this will lead me to my research questions. That's our first, what's the influence of preventive measures to residential buildings for people with the aging population? And what's the influence of the intervention time of the fire service on the fire safety in residential buildings with aging people? Now, how can I measure this degree of fire safety? I will do that with an AST-RST analysis. And the AST is defined by the conditions in the room. And the RST is defined by different parameters based on the human characteristics. As we said, as we have seen tomorrow, you can see that this is also applied. And for elderly, the safety margin is small of isn't even there. So if you look at buildings where all the people are housed, you can see always pictures like this. Big buildings, people live at the same floor, all together with elderly, and high-rise buildings. Now, I applied this in my research, and I selected two floor plans from the Rijksdienst voor Ondernemend Nederland. They designed some reference buildings, and two of them I applied in my research. That's the basic for my simulations. So, I've got a building, and now I've got to put a fire in this building. And I chose for this fire, a fire in a complete living room that starts in an object, in this case a sofa, and it will grow till a complete room. This is just one fire. Each fire is different, so I made some variation on this graph. I applied a factor on the XS, which I mean time constant. So I doubled it up and half it up. And I applied a factor at the IAS. And there I mean the maximum grow rate, burning capacity. Now we got a building, we got a fire, and I can simulate and I can analyze the data. And to analyze the data, I have to define what is acceptable for these people in this building. I made a selection of two criteria. One criteria for an independent escape. In this scenario, a building user will be able to walk out the room. And the second scenario, an intervention of the fire service is needed. So the first criteria, I had really strict parameters. An effect smoke wire of 1.0 is based on the visual length of 5 meters. A radiation heat of 2.5 kilowatt at square meter. And a convective heat of 121 degrees Celsius. In the second scenario, I applied a different criteria, and it's based on surviving. This criteria has a fat smoke value of 0.3 for heat and for carbon monoxide, and a minimum oxygen level of 60,000 ppm. Oh, sorry, I thought you raised your hand. So I applied this two criteria for the AST, and I did the same for the RST. In the RST, first a scenario whereby the people walks independent outside. So you got a detection time, warning time, recognition time, response time, and travel time. And in the second scenario, we replace the response time and travel time for reporting time, fire service response time, and rescue time. He wants to sit in the first situation, but with the elderly, it's not even not always possible to get in the situation, and then necessary to intervene by the fire service. So, what I did in my research, each parameter I determined average value. For example, here I used the fire service turnout time of volunteers. In my region, it's 278 seconds before they turn out. Yeah, that's the average value. But someone turns out faster, someone turns out take longer. So I put a distribution on that. I based the distribution on the standard deviation that I obtained from the statics for my safety region. Now, so this is just one parameter, and I put this parameter all together, and I will present you the results of the situation in the fire room and analysis between AST and RST for an intervention by the fire service and an independent escape. This is the most worst case scenario, so I have done this for the different rooms. And you can see the chance of success is very low. Independent escape will success in almost 30%, but an escape by the fire service, almost 0% of success.
At least fairly low. Yeah. This maybe seem like some weird graphs or something, but it really shows where Mike's research stands out from previous research. We've had previous research which concluded the fire department is always late, of is late to do a rescue. And it was true in that research. It was a good conclusion. They did a research on a very fast evolving fire inside a house with all the interior door open. And then after about 10-15 minutes, the fire department came and they were too late to do a rescue. So it was a good research. But some other people take that conclusion, don't take the considerations of the research in mind, and just saying the fire department is always late. Then it goes wrong. And the nice thing about Mike's research is that he has a distribution on every parameter, so there's a little bit more nuance to it. And now it's not, there's no chance that the fire department will do a rescue. Now the fire department has a chance of doing a rescue in this percentage of fires. About this graph, Mike already told you something about average value and distribution. If the average value goes up, in this case the blue line, will go to the right. If the distribution of all the values decreases, the line will go more vertically. And those are two means of improving fire safety. You could decrease the average value in which the fire service does their intervention, but you can also decrease the amount of distribution and therefore make it more assured that they will always be in a smaller part of the time and therefore have a more vertical line.
Yeah.
Back to you, Mike.
Yeah, my research, I want to place the blue line to the left of the red line to the right. Yeah, and this is your part of the interactive deal part.
Oh yeah, that's true. Well, it's a workshop, so you will have to do something as well. It's a little bit after lunch. I hope you still have some energy. Almost time for dinner, but just the last bit you have left, we'll take it out. I'm going to divide you into two groups. You can take it to the next sheet, please.
Yeah.
I'm going to make this group number one. Why not? And Robin White? Yes. I'm going to make you the chair of group number one.
Right.
Okay? Pay good attention. I've got two things here regarding the required safe time. On top, the required safe time for a situation where the person can flee independently. On the bottom, for the situation where the fire service has to do a rescue. Group one, I want you to take the upper part, the five times on the bottom. Detection, warning, recognition, response, and travel. You know what they mean? Yeah? Good. He's almost finishing his, he's almost ready with his, well, let's say, education in becoming a fire officer, right? So he knows all about this. If you have any question, ask the chair. I've got a sheet for you over there. I want you to first task, write down the five times. That's easy. I've got a oops and flops. And then afterwards, I want you to have a discussion with your group and rank them. Which time has the most influence on the total required safe time for a situation where they have to flee independently? Then we've got group number two. You've got exactly the same task, but then for the bottom one, with detection, warning, recognition, reporting, response, and rescue time. Are those times clear what they mean? If not, ask Joost, he is your chair. I saw him dozing away a little bit, so I thought it was time to wake him up. Also, my dear colleague, who made a lot of fine videos for me for my workshop tomorrow. Thank you for that. Maybe that's why he was dozing off. He worked a lot of hours, but... and for you, the same task. Write them down. Over there, there's a sheet. There are some markers. And rank them. What is on the required safe time for an situation with an intervention has the most input on the total time. Let's say 5 minutes, or we'll see. Make the rank, and then the chair will present the resultations of their group. Is that clear to everybody? I don't hear a no, so that'll be fine. Then I wish you all good luck.
Mooi wat je zegt. Ik heb nog wel eens geleden, zeg maar.
White. Under pressure, everything comes out fine. Thank you. Let's see and look at the results. Robin, could you take the sheet over here? Then we can have it on camera and everybody can see it. Yeah, you did nice. Ali likes it, but you can give it to Mike. I think he will hold it up for me. So you said some times. Can you explain it to me a little?
Of course. So we have the five times that are making up the total escape time. First of all, the detection. Well, that's mostly influenced by whether or not there's a detector. Because detection can occur both visually or by audio in case of a detector. We said that detection can take up to 15 minutes when there's no detector in place. So that's a big part of the required escape time. After that follows the warning. Take into account that people can be sleeping, can have hearing problems. So that can be influenced by not only giving an audio signal, but also a physical stimulus by, for example, a vibrating mattress. But that still can take up to 5 minutes when these type of stimulus are not in place. After that, the recognition, okay, I hear something, but what does it mean? About a minute. And then the response, well, that both response and travel depend on the physical state of the person. And response time is, does somebody act accurately on the situation or not? So we think that might take up to 5 minutes as well. And after that, the travel time, so from the place that they're in to the front door, which is a maximum of 30 meters, taking into account some smoke and stress, might be 2 minutes as well. Taking everything into consideration, I think the biggest factor still is the detection indeed.
Okay. Nice summary. The detection is the biggest factor of influence. To the opinion of your group, travel and recognition time are fairly low. Response and warning time are a little bit in the middle. Mike is going to show what he did in his research and what came out of it. For now, thank you very much for sharing. Maybe a round of applause for Robin. And thank you, group number one. Now up to group number two, Chair Abus.
We had some discussion and some wrong information.
Yeah, a little bit of discussion.
But we talked about... we thought the people have to be rescued. They are in a situation that they cannot come out themselves. But it's very important that there is detection. And we said, okay, in homes we might have a smoke alarm in the way in the hallways, and then the detection time might be 5 minutes. When it's in every room, the detection time is 1 minute. So if we do something with the detection time, we know earlier that there's a fire. But when you look at the warning time, so the time it takes for the people to hear the fire alarm, it might take a long time because somebody's deaf or asleep or taking medicine and doesn't know what's wrong. So the question is, if they recognize the smoke alarm and remember what it, what's the problem when they hear a smoke alarm, that they have to do something. But the problem is reporting, because when they don't recognize the smoke alarm or know what to do, it's very important that somebody reports to the fire department they are in trouble and they need help. And we had a little discussion, and some of us were also a fire investigator. I know people don't call the fire department, they call the neighbors and said, hey, we have smoke in the house, what do I have to do? Please call the fire department. So they won't call the fire service themselves. They don't want to bother anybody else with their problems. So we think it's very important that detection time is number one, reporting time is number two. The response time, we had a discussion about that, but in a lot of cities, they made the roads from 50 kilometers an hour to 30 kilometers an hour with a lot of bumps in it, so this might go up. Then the rescue time, we had the discussion, it's where is the fire? Is it on the ground floor, on the 11th floor? And we don't know how many people are coming. Is a full fire truck with six people on it or four people on it? Or that's, so we think detection is number one, reporting number two, recognition with lights, sounds, moving beds, I don't know what, could be interesting. The warning time that they hear it, and number five and number six, I explained it. So that's what we think.
Thank you very much, Chair Abus. Yes. A lot of interesting points regarding rescue time. Very true. It will depend a lot if it's just a singular home, first floor, or you have to go up to the 30th floor and do a rescue over there. Also influence rescue time a lot, because then you know where you have to go. Otherwise, you have to tell where to go from smoke or some other parts. And where the smoke is doesn't always really means where the fire is. So that's a good thing. Thank you very much. A lot of nice input for us. And now Mike will show you what he did in his research and what in his research, the most influencing factors are.
Yeah, in the first scenario, a scenario with an independent escape, the detection time is the very most important factor in comparing to the others. I've made a separation between variances, also called uncentry, that is the line, the stijlheid van de lijn.
Steepness or slope?
Slope of line. And the place of the line, the average value, is it placed to the right or to the left? The most important factor of that is the detection time. The detection time is very high because not always is there a smoke detector present in the buildings. We studied residential buildings, not buildings with a care function where an automatic fire system is present. And in Netherlands, the fire smoke detector density among elderly is lower than average in the Netherlands, and average is around 70%, and among elderly it's just 65% that a working smoke detector is present. So the detection time can go out to 15 minutes, and it has a great influence to this parameters. Yeah, heb je aanvulling?
No. Okay. Not really.
It's it looks like this. Very good.
Maybe one thing, that there's a lot of the same things as was said before. There's a lot of distribution in detection time. And one of the things Group 1 said, well, you can never travel too far, maybe not even more than 10 meters in such a small apartment. So it can never take a whole lot of time. And you see it over here in the average value, not a lot of distribution around the average value. So there's not a bit of factor of influence there. And there's also means that there's not much you can do about that. If it's not big already, you can't reduce it enough. So if you want to do anything regarding the required safe time in this situation, doing something about detection time seems the most obvious.
Yeah, it's very comparable with what's described here. Only the warning timers in my research are a little bit shorter, about 1 or 2 minutes. In the second scenario, it's a little bit different. You can see not always the not only the detection time is very important, but also the rescue time and the fire service response time is important. The fire service response time is important in the blue line. That means the average time, the total time of the response of the fire service. In the Safety Region Act, we say that's 8 minutes, but not always we reach this 8 minutes, and sometimes longer. The detection time has some incentives, and the rescue time is very different, dependent on the situation. In a high-rise building, it takes longer than where you've got row houses. Here's some incentives. These are the three most important factors that influence the total required safe time for an intervention by the fire service. So with these three parameters, I want to take measures to improve the fire safety. These are parameters that I used for the determination of the required safe time. And these are the parameters that I used to make influence on the available safe time. In the situation I in left in Dutch and right in English, these are the parameters. At fire characteristics, so soot yield, CO yield, heat of combustion, but also building characteristics. Are doors open or door closed? Is there mechanical ventilation present? Is it on? Is it off? And are windows open and off? All of them are applied in the research with an average situation and a maximum and a lowest situation. And this will bring me the probability distribution that I displayed yet. If I do the same thing for these parameters, I see that in the fire room, the time constant is the most important factor for the available safe time. On both criteria, on criteria for an escape and criteria for surviving. So if I want to change the conditions in the fire room, I have to change something with the time constant, the speed of growing the fire. Other factors are less important. If I look this same analysis for the other rooms, rooms not in the fire room but connected to the fire room, the hallway or the bedrooms, it is a little bit different. The door between the fire room and the other rooms is here the most important factor for both criteria. The windows in the other rooms, windows OR, has a little bit in influence because they can exist smoke or bring fresh air with influence the available safe time in the other rooms. Other factors are very less important. In my research, I applied a little measures, and Ruud will take you with me in that.
Yep. Yeah, you can go to the next one. We did some of, actually I didn't do anything, Mike did all the work. But Mike looked at some things which can be done to improve fire safety, which can improve survivability for the residents in the buildings we looked at. In terms of preventive measures, and maybe we'll have a discussion what is preventive here, but some are a little bit on the repression side. We looked at, Mike looked at a lot of things, but I want to talk to you about four things today. One thing is smoke detector density, that is which percentage of homes have a smoke detector applied in their home.
In my favorite situation is only 65% in the buildings has a working smoke detector.
Yep. The second thing is the smoke detector level of safety. Is there only a smoke detector in the hallway of the apartment, or is there a smoke detector in every room in the apartment? Third thing, reporting by neighbors. I'm going to use a Dutch word now, but there's something called naberschap in the east of the Netherlands. It's something, if a fire alarm goes off over here, the neighbors are also warned that there's a fire by their neighbors where an elderly person lives. the neighbor goes over and tries to help and get the person out. Third thing is civilian assistance, which is more or less the same, but on a broader scale. So with reporting by neighbors, it's just the neighbors that are alarmed. People who are nearby and will be at the fire address fast, but only one or two persons live there. So the probability of one also reporting to that fire, being home and being able to help the other person to flee out, maybe a little bit lower. With civilian assistance, it's something like IED alert. More people get alarmed, but it might take them a bit longer to get to the address where the fire is. So a higher probability of someone showing up who can help, but maybe arriving a little bit late, and therefore it will be tougher to do to help a person to flee. It might be the conditions of the fire also in such a manner that there's no possibility of helping the person escape. Normally, I would ask you to all stand up, move around the room, choose a place, but we've got, well, let's say 25 minutes left. I'm going to short it up a little because we have a drink afterwards, and that's also important. Out of these measures, I want to ask you, which do you think is most important? I'm going to go over all four of them. And I want to ask you to raise your hand if I name the one which you think is most important. Which of these measures will help survivability inside a room most? Who thinks raising the smoke detector density is the biggest factor? Okay. 10 people. Who thinks the smoke detector level of safety is most important? Okay. Reporting by neighbors? No one. Okay. Are you all having angry neighbors or? Civilian assistance? Okay, so it's just smoke detectors here. It's going to be interesting telling the results from your research, but we're not going to go there already. Okay. The lady up front. You chose for smoke detector density. Can you tell me why?
If there's not a smoke detector in the house, people will know that there is a fire. And reporting by neighbors, well, they won't always be able to see that there's a fire going on. So,
so you're telling one thing, well, you need the smoke detector, otherwise all the other actions can't be done?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's a starting point. No detection of fire. Well, no other things can happen. And your neighbor, are you doing reporting my neighbors? Okay. Well, no problem. You choose for level of safety?
I think that when there are more smoke detectors in different rooms, you will be alarmed faster. So that's why.
Yeah, I can't argue with that. More smoke detectors or smoke detectors in every room will reduce the average value of your detection time. And we saw detection time was an important factor in the required save time. Well, Mike all looked at this very carefully, and he will show you what is most important.
Yeah. Yeah, first, extra every measure is positive to the influence of the fire safety. Every measure can apply it, but placing extra smoke detector in the living room and in the bedroom has a much more greater effect than just only placing extra detectors in the buildings where no smoke detector is present.
I'm gonna tell one thing about this graph. On top, it's the reference value, the basic situation which we calculated. And it is set at 100%. So the average time or the average distribution for the basic situation is put at 100%. If you reduce the required save time, it goes to the left. So all the things that are to the left the most, those are the best solutions. And there's, of course, Mike did a probabilistic approach. So there's two things, the average value and the distribution.
Yes. So in some cases, the door between the fire room and the corridor is closed. In the current situation, the smoke detector is in the corridor. So the detection time takes much longer. And extra smoke detector in the fire room, so in the living room, and an extra smoke detector in the bedroom, results in a much faster detection time. If you place a smart detector, and detector is connected to smartphones from the neighbors, it has a great influence. Sometimes they can go out to carry out a little intervention when the fire is very small, or there's a burning thing on the cooking apply. You can take an intervention, or you can take people outside the building. In the second scenario, the time to get to the location for the fire is a little bit higher, so the conditions in the room are a little bit different, and it's not always even possible to carry out an intervention. So reporting my neighbors is more effective than reporting civilians. But all measures are positive to the fire safety.
Did you take the chance of failure into account?
Yes.
For just for the video, yep. He was asking if the chance of failure is taken into account, because the he assumes that the smoke detector will have a lower probability of failure than civilian assisting or reporting by neighbors.
Yes, I did. In this scenario, this is because there's not really a big difference between a reference situation and the 100% situation. Here we place three smoke detectors, so the probability of failure is very low. You can, you've got three detectors, so one of the three will always work. And in this situation, there will be indeed a situation where neighbors are not at home, or not even in a situation they can go to intervene. But still, the times that they get an intervention will result in this great difference. Yeah, of course.
Why is it still so so big? Reporting neighbors is so
question is, why is reporting by neighbors so well, let's say, small in terms of average value and distribution? If you take into account that you need a smoke detector in order to make that work.
In this condition, we're looking at the required save time in the second scenario. And the wavelength situation, there is an intervention of the fire service needed. So in this situation, also an intervention of the fire service is needed. But additional to that, the civilian assistance is applied. Thus, when they are available, they can maybe carry out a rescue. That's only in a positive way. And if they are not in the situation that they can carry out the rescue, you come also in the traditional situation that the fire service carry out the rescue.
These results, of course, will be different if you look at the situation where the person will be able to flee independently. Yes. Yeah, the question is, why is civilian assistant, let's say, a lesser good measure than reporting neighbors?
Yeah, because we assume that reporting neighbors has a lower intervention time. They get sooner at the location, but the time to, the chance that someone has go to the location of the incident is lower. In this situation, the chance that someone goes to the location of the incident is higher, But the average time that someone needs to go to the fire location is 1 minute longer. And the conditions in the room are very different 1 minute later, and not always is possible to carry out an intervention, rescue or intervention.
With the times we took with civilian assistance, they are a little bit higher for the person to arrive at the scene. And the fire has grown too big by then in a lot of situations in order to really help the person flee out. That's why.
This is a small scale applied in the Netherlands in the Achterhoek at this time, but this is completely new. This is not even applied at this time. So it's very innovative, and more research has to be done before we can maybe apply this. We have to make good afspraken, appointments.
Yeah, when we implement it, we have to look at, well, what is needed to tell the people who are joining the civilian assistance, what can you do, what can you do in case of a fire, how are we technically are going to do everything, how are people going to be able to get inside the homes of the people they want to help. So there's a lot of questions left over there, but in theory it could work.
Yeah, you don't want that there are more victims after this measure than there are before, but yeah, maybe it can help.
It might be a misunderstood something somewhere, but as I understand, the reference is the overall response, required safety time, and that depends on the detection.
Yeah.
As one of the five parameters.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we did over there, the detection could be, if there was no fire alarm at all, something. And if the fire alarm was there, it could take a minute or something, if it's working. But the reference that you're having is, of course, a product of all five of them, and is then based on an average on a lot of simulations or a lot of cases where in some cases you had the fire alarm, in some cases you didn't have the fire alarm.
Yeah, in the airset scenario, that's based on the literature studies. So sometimes there's a smoke detector present and sometimes not. Okay. And the available safe time is based on simulations.
And okay. Also one good thing to point out, we are looking at the scenario of group two now. So it's not a scenario where the person can flee independently, but it's a scenario where an intervention of the fire service is needed. So in that case, the detection time is a little bit less of a factor. And in our reference situation, 65% of the homes have a smoke detector. So only 35% of them don't. It's less. Yeah. Significantly less than for group one.
Yep.
Yeah? Let's go on.
For the next measures, I will look into the measures that we can apply at the fire service. For that, it's maybe necessary to notice it. In the Netherlands, we got two types of fire service. Fire service by volunteers and fire service by professionals. Professionals are stationed at the fire station at each time, and volunteers are at work or at home and come to the fire station in case of an emergency. So the alarm time of both is really the same, but the turnout time, the time of alarm or fire service unit to turn out from the fire station, is different. Professionals turn out in almost 100 seconds, and volunteers need almost 300 seconds to turn out. The drive time of volunteers is a little bit shorter than professionals, and it will show. So, why is that? Because they want to meet the requirements in the Fire Safety Region Act. They want to be able to get in the location at 8 minutes. So they can turn out faster, so they can drive a little farther. But in practice, they get not the 8 minutes in the most times. So it will result in professionals will turn out in almost 500 seconds, and volunteers needs, yeah, almost 600 seconds. A difference of 100 seconds between volunteers and professionals, and that's based on statics from my safety region, Brandweer-Brabant Noord. So some measures that Ruud will explain.
Yeah, well, Mike looked at measures on the preventive side, but also on the side of the fire department. Is there anything that we can improve over there in order to increase fire safety for the elderly? We looked at three things. First thing is area-specific response times. It might not mean that much for the non-Dutch people over here. We are currently looking at a way of saying, well, this is the location of the fire station. Around the fire station is a circle where we can meet the standards regarding turnout time. And in Mike's research, we assumed that for the buildings necessary, they are around in this circle. And we can meet the times that are prescribed in the Safety Region Act. So for this measure, we will reduce the area-specific response times. For the ones that aren't over there, we didn't look at them, but we will assume that there are some extra preventive measures are taken. Second solution was day occupation of fire stations. Fire prevention officers or the persons working at the fire department can work at the fire station on a day basis. So on work days from 8 to 16:30, I believe.
Yeah. Workable days.
People are working at the fire station and they can drive away after 1 minute after the alarm. So you have a reduction of a few minutes there. And the last measure was a rapid intervention vehicle. Works 365 days a week, 24 hours a day. You can also turn out faster because you need less people and maybe a fully equipped fire truck with six persons will come a little bit later. Those are the three solutions. Again, the question for you, which one do you think has the biggest influence on fire safety? Who thinks area-specific response times? Nobody. Okay. Day occupation of fire stations. Also nobody. Ah, we've got a few. Dirk and Robin, thank you. Rapid intervention vehicle. A few more hands. The rest has fallen asleep. Okay. Dirk, why day occupation? Because you do that in Rosmalen or... Yeah.
Well, you reduce the time that the vehicle is arriving at the fire house. If I have to choose between those three, the first one, the area specific response time, and you only have a calculated time, and the rapid intervention vehicle, it depends on how many people you stay, you put on the intervention vehicle if you've been able to do a rescue. So it can be paper, 5 minutes
shorter, but you do have only intervention. Yep. The day occupation of fire station with people to rescue is the best option. Okay, so you're saying with day occupation, you're sure when you arrive at the fire scene, you're up to the job you have to do. And with a rapid intervention vehicle, you might only be with two persons, and you can be able to do everything you want. Okay. Who said the rapid intervention vehicle? Then we're gonna go over here. Henk.
I would say a rapid intervention vehicle because you can look at the situation, what is it, and act with the backup team, make a good view of what is needed there. And then, or attack the fire yourself, make the intervention yourself, or the backup team can do it.
So you're saying with a rapid intervention vehicle, you can have a good scan of the fire, make a plan, and when the backup team arrives, then you can start. Okay, thank you. Well, of course, Mike did a lot of work, and he's going to tell you what he found out.
I got the results, and the average time in each situation is reduced a little bit, only 10-15%. But in the situation of the decompensation, is the uncertainty much larger than in the wavefront situation. This is because the day situation, they turn out in 1 minute, and the evening 3 or 4 minutes. So there is more uncertainty, but the average time is shorter, so it's a better result for the fire safety. All three scenarios are only 10-15% reducing the wavefront situation. That's because all of them are still dependent on the detection time. If the detection time is very long, the fire department can drive faster or turn out faster, but the result of the safety margin is very reduced. So if you compare this to the results at the preventive measures, you can see the difference, and then you can see the preventive measures are more has more result than the repressive measures, but both can maybe combined to improve the fire safety.
Yeah, and again, there's not one magic thing that you can do to make everybody safe. It's a pretty complicated problem. We saw it this morning in Hans and Liewe, their presentation. We have to look at a lot of different things in order to make homes for the elderly fire safe.
Yeah. So I will then end up with answers to my research questions. I start with, and what's the influence of preventive measures to the fire safety of residential buildings by aging people? And what is the influence of the intervention time? Now, the preventive measures are more effective than the repressive measures, and intervention time is just a small part of all times together. Some conclusions of my research. I applied fireproof furniture in the fire room, and that's the only measure that I applied in my research that conditions in the fire room improved. To apply this more, it's very important to make it attractive to consumers to buy this fireproof furniture, or stimulate producers to produce more fireproof mobiliar. Maybe some regulation can contribute to more fireproof furniture. Closing doors is a very important factor for the smoke spread in other rooms, not in the fire room. There's no negative influence to the fire room, but a very large positive effect to the other rooms. We can apply some technical results, but you can also change the human behavior to put doors closed. The leakage of the door is the most important factor when the door is closed. That depends the amount of smoke in the other rooms. And a very small part of my research is rescue after ventilation. In some cases, can be necessary to ventilate a room before someone is rescued. You can think in some victim is in the bedroom, fire is in the living room, smoke is in the corridor, and maybe you can first put out the fire and exhaust the smoke before you can rescue something. But it's very dependent on the situation and very dependent on where's the location of the fire and the location of the victim. More research is necessary, and Ruud is at this time busy with it. On the other side, you can improve the required safe time, and you can do that to improve the fire of the smoke detector density, upgrade to level 2, dus place an extra smoke detector in the living room and in the bedroom, and you have to stimulate the building owners. Measures that can apply by the fire service is area specific intervention times are good determining of the priorities, and in large cities and RIV and a rapid intervention vehicle can be a solution. Alternatives with maybe they need a little bit more research, but maybe they are very effective are reporting by neighbors of civilian assistance. And maybe it's a starting point for new research into this topic. I will thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, then you can ask them to us.
I will walk upwards to you. so I don't have to repeat it. It's almost done. I'm lazy.
It's a long question. No, it's a short question. Why did you consider sprinklers in the dwellings?
That's a good question. I get them earlier. I based my solutions at the factors from the problem analysis. I simulated in CFast, and we thought it is very difficult to make good simulations with the sprinklers. Other reports also research into sprinkler or water mist water spray installations. So we think we make simple solutions that we all can apply, extra smoke detector or closing a door, and we'll see what the effect is in relation to repressive measures. Okay? More questions? Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.